Bless the name of Jesus. We are looking forward to Sunday school this morning. We're doing all we can to get there. Amen. Let me call your attention to the Sunday school lesson for today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you now, Lord. We bless your name. We thank you for your mercy and your grace. We thank you for another privilege, another chance, another opportunity to come. We ask you, Father God, to bless us as we transmit over the airways. We pray that you bless our message, bless our Sunday school class, bless those who listen. We ask you, Father God, to continue to walk with us and bless us on today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank God. Let's look at our Sunday school. There are some who are probably perusing on my page. My page doesn't look like it's one to cooperate, but I want to welcome you here to Sister Carolyn Davis' page here at the New Beginning Church. We're looking at Acts chapter 18 and Romans chapter 16. Acts chapter 18 and Romans chapter 16. And the writers have kind of jumped around and tried to make their appeal today. I'm going to ask Sister Davis to come and read for us these verses.
Okay, we are reading from Acts 18 and 1, and it reads as follows. After these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth and found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because that Claudius had commanded all Jews to depart from Rome and came unto them. And because he was of the same craft, he abode with them and wrought. But by their occupation, they were tent makers. Acts 18 and 18. And Paul, after this, tarried there yet a good while, and then took his leave of the brethren, and sailed thence to Syria, and with him Priscilla and Aquila, having shorn his head in Cenchreae, for he had a vow. Verse 19, and he came to Ephesus and left them there. But he himself entered into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. Verse 20, then they desired him to tarry longer time with them. He consented not, but bade them farewell, saying, I must by all means keep this feast that cometh in Jerusalem, but I will return again unto you, if God will. And he sailed from Ephesus. Verse number 24, and a certain Jew named Apollos, born in Alexandria, an eloquent man and mighty in the scriptures, came to Ephesus. This man was instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in the spirit, he spake and talked diligently the things of the Lord, knowing only the baptism of John. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. There, when Aquila and Priscilla had heard, they took him unto them and expounded unto him the way of God more perfectly. Romans 16, verses 3 and 4. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ Jesus, who have for my life laid down their own necks, unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Davis. We are looking at this Sunday school lesson, and as we look through this Sunday school lesson, it is entitled Priscilla, Call to Minister. Priscilla, Call to Minister. Let me just say to you today, this topic, this subject matter, this lesson, Priscilla, Call to Minister, is very misleading with the passages of scripture that have been chosen. But we will look at the fact, not only is Priscilla mentioned here as one called to minister, Paul, Aquila, and Apollos are mentioned throughout these scriptures that we deal with in this Sunday school lesson, to minister. So many are called to minister. This word minister means to serve. It means to present the word of God. And we all know that we're all called to present the word of God. And so we must always be aware that the scripture, the word of God, takes precedence over anything that any man can come up with. So let's look at this Sunday school lesson. Sister Davis has read the scriptures. So I want to bring out some highlights. As we all know, we're having some technical difficulties. I want to bring out some highlights that are found in these scriptures. First of all, the author jumps from one place to the other as he writes this lesson, and it leaves it up for us to use our daily readings to tie it together. So those of you who are following the daily reading, I want to say to you, it is very imperative that we continue to follow the daily reading, read the daily reading, so that way we can have a good understanding of what the book is really talking about and what the Sunday school lesson is really all about. So let's look with me. As we look at these verses and these three passages of scripture, I want you to keep in mind, first of all, we must seek opportunities to use our gifts or our abilities to further the gospel of Jesus Christ. God has given us opportunities. God will always drop in our presence opportunities to share Jesus Christ. God has continually given us opportunities to share Jesus Christ. Therefore, we must seek those opportunities. We must look for those opportunities to share Jesus Christ and his gospel. Yes, we must continue to look at these opportunities because God will present us with them. So the Sunday school lesson tells us at the end of this lesson, we must seek opportunities to utilize our gifts and utilize our skills as well as our abilities to further the gospel of Jesus Christ. We must look forward to pushing and furthering the gospel of Jesus Christ. There are two questions I want you to ask yourself as we cover these verses, as we cover this Sunday school lesson this morning. Number one, what skills do you have that can be used to directly further the gospel of Jesus Christ? What skills do you have? What have God given you? What techniques, what skills, what abilities have God given you by which you can directly impact the world through the gospel of Jesus Christ? I need to know, you need to know, what have God given you? What is it? Your speech? Is it your demeanor? Is it your conversation? Is it your style? Is it your lifestyle? What has God given to you? What skills do you have that God has given to you that further directly impact the gospel of Jesus Christ? The next question that I want you to consider as we cover this lesson this morning, how can you use your skills in a way to help others share the gospel of Jesus Christ? How can you use the skills that God has given you that you will be a benefit to help others share the gospel of Jesus Christ? And as we cover these passages, you will see that as we are yokemen in the gospel, as we are laborers and co-laborers in the gospel, we will see for sure, we will see without a shadow of a doubt that we are called by God to help others to carry the gospel of Jesus Christ regardless of where we go. We are to help others. We are to be beneficiaries of Jesus Christ, that we can help others be beneficiaries of Jesus Christ. We can benefit from it. And not only can we benefit, we can help others benefit that they can help others benefit. Amen? So it becomes a domino effect. We have to take our skills to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. As I've said before, this lesson does not focus strictly on Priscilla. It focuses on Paul more than Priscilla. It focuses on his missionary journeys. It takes us from one city, one area of the country to the other. It tracks Paul's ministry, and Paul is ministering in a point and in a time where it is really dangerous to talk about Jesus Christ. And we will see as we cover the scriptures. It also talks about Aquila. Aquila, this man Aquila, was one who had ministered with Paul, and he and his wife had ministered to others along with Paul. Let's look at it. When we look at the verses, we will find out that first of all, when we look at verse number, and as I said, they skip around a lot. When we look at verses 1 through 17 of Acts chapter 18, beginning at verse number 1, and he moves from verse number 1 strategically to verse number 17. Now, verses 4 and 17 are missing, but in order for you to appreciate what is being talked about, you need to understand what is happening in verses 4 through 17. So he says in verses number 1, 2, and 3, it mentions that Paul, after these things, after the things that happened in chapter 17, Paul moves and he departs from Athens and he goes to Corinth. Corinth is the place where you find the book of Corinthians written to these people. Corinth is that city, is that place where Paul writes 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, and some historians believe that there was a 3 Corinthians that is not published in our Bible. And you know and I know that the Apostle Paul had to talk directly to the Corinthians because they were some rascals, because they were messed up. Because they were just like us in Houston, just like us in Texas, just like us in the whole United States and the world. So Paul writes this letter. He moves from Athens to Corinthians, and he found a certain Jew. First of all, we find out that Aquila is a Jew. Not only does he find Aquila there, who's a Jew, he also finds there his wife, Priscilla. So these two was a dynamic duo, Aquila and Priscilla. They worked together in ministry. They worked together. It is an awesome thing when a couple can work together in the same ministry. It is a great thing when a couple can minister to other people with each other. So Aquila and Priscilla were together in ministry. And they were called together in ministry. Please remember that the word ministry here is service. The word ministry is to present the gospel of Jesus Christ. The word ministry is to witness and to share the gospel. We are all called to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. When we move to verse number 3, we will find out that Paul stayed with Priscilla and Aquila. And when he stayed with them, they had stuff in common. What did they have in common? They were tent makers. Paul was a tent maker. Aquila and Priscilla was tent makers. Now this word tent makers also refers to leather makers or leather workers. So they worked with leather in order to make tents. And they earn their living through building and creating and making tents. Amen? And as they built and made tents, when Paul shows up, they welcome Paul into their place. The text declares that Paul stayed there a year and a half, stayed with them. Now, in today's vernacular, we will find those who have a common craft are in competition with each other. But in the ancient world, those who had a common craft, they created what is known as a consortium, meaning they created a group and they supported each other. How much better would it be if we would just support each other in the things that we do? If we have the same craft, we ought to be willing to share that craft. We ought to be willing to share what our knowledge of what we know about things. We have to be willing to do that. Paul stayed with them. They were willing to share with Paul, and Paul was willing to share with them. Therefore, Paul stayed at their house. He dwelled with them. He lived with them for about a year and a half. And they were tent makers. They had the same craft. There was no competition. They were drawn to each other. And their spirits ministered to each other. And not only that, their spirits were in agreement with each other. So we conclude that not only did they minister together physically, in their secular world, but they also ministered together in the spiritual world. In other words, they were friends, they were buddies, they hung out together, they were co-laborers together, number one, as tent makers, and they were co-laborers together in the word of God. They weren't like we are these days. You get a person on the job and you say, I can't teach him or her everything I know, as if they're gonna steal what God has given to you. Paul, Priscilla, and Aquila, they worked through things together. They were co-laborers in their craft. There was no competition. They did not have no competition. They did not have a no-compete clause. They didn't have to have that because they understood, if I can help you, I'm going to do whatever I can to help you. Now, a lot of things happen between verses 3 and verse 18. So here we have verses 4 through 17. And if you read your daily reading, you would know that some things happen. What happened was there was a new kid on the block. There was a new governor. And this governor was like a judge in a courtroom. This new governor came on the scene. His name was Galileo. And Galileo was on the scene, and as long as Paul was ministering the word of God in the first place, people were getting along. But when Galileo shows up, when he becomes a new governor, then the people rose up against Paul. What they wanted to do is take Paul to court, put him in front of Galileo and tell him that he's giving us a problem and he's doing things illegally. Look at verses 4 through verse 17. You will find out that when Paul went from one place to the other, he preached the word, and he was preaching the word at all times. He was always in the synagogue, always preaching the word. He testified to the Jews that Jesus is the Messiah. And as Paul ministered, so did so many others like Silas and Timothy. They ministered the same thing. And whenever people, in verse number 6, whenever people did not accept Paul's message, he shook the dust, the Bible says, shook the dust from his head and shook the dust from his feet. In other words, Paul did not try to pressure them to receive the word, but he shook his feet, shook his head, and said to them, you need to understand that I've done what I'm called to do, but I want you to understand the blood of the people is on your hand. The blood of the people is on your heads. He says, I'm not responsible, I am innocent. When you look at this thing that's going on, he presented the word of God. We are called to present the word of God. We are called to witness for the Lord. We are called to minister to people as Paul did, as Priscilla and Aquila did. We are called to minister. We are called to be helpers to the minister. We are not called to give the minister a problem. We are not called to set the minister straight. We are truly called to be helpers as Priscilla and Aquila did in their day. Paul left and he moved from one point to the other. He moved to the house of Tychicus Justus, who was a Gentile. Here we see that the Jews did not accept Paul's message fully. Many of them became Christians, so they were Jewish Christians, but some of them did not accept Paul's message. And as they didn't accept Paul's message, Paul moved right on to the Gentiles. And when he moved to the Gentiles, there was a guy who stayed next door to the church, next door to the synagogue, old Justus himself, Tychicus Justus. He lived next door to the church. He lived next door, and he was there to minister with Paul. Paul moved in. Paul worked with them. And not only did he believe the gospel, but his whole household believed the gospel. He believed the gospel. And many others in Corinth believed the gospel. There were Cyprus. Cyprus was a leader in the synagogue. Everybody in his household believed the gospel. Paul is making his rounds. Paul is ministering to the word of God to everybody he met. The Bible says he ministered the word of God on a regular basis. He did it well. He was consistent. He was persistent, even in the face of opposition. Verse number 9, God speaks. This is Acts 18, verse number 9. God speaks to Paul. Paul is leading people to believe on Jesus Christ, and he's also leading people into baptism, as identified in verse number 8 of Acts chapter 18. He is leading people to believe on Jesus, and he's also leading people to be baptized. He is. So one night, Paul knew his situation was dangerous. He knew the situation was critical. He knew that he could get in trouble with the law for ministering Jesus the Christ. So one night God spoke to him and gave him confidence. Verse number 9, it says, one night the Lord spoke to Paul in a vision. And these are the things he said to him. Don't be afraid. Speak out. Don't be silent. For I am with you, and no one will attack and harm you, for many people in this city belong to me. So God gives him confidence, give Paul confidence to keep on ministering, to keep on moving, to keep on doing what he's called to do. He says, one night in a dream, he says to him, don't be afraid. Speak out. Don't be silent. For I'm with you. It's a good thing to know that the Lord is with you. For I'm with you. No one will attack you. No one will harm you. For many people are with me in this city. Many people who belong to me are in this city. So Paul stayed for the next year and a half teaching the word of God. It's a good thing when you can make the preacher comfortable. It's a good thing when you make the messenger comfortable. It's a good thing when you can make the messenger so comfortable that he will stay with you a year and a half. It's a great thing. It's a great thing that Paul was able to minister to these people for a year and a half. He stayed there. But look what happens in verse number 12. But when Gallio shows up, he becomes the governor of Acadia, and some of the Jews rose against Paul. Verse number 12, Acts chapter 18. Some of the Jews rose against Paul. So now they have a new governor, and they've come to the conclusion, this governor will shut Paul down. So we're going to take Paul to court. This governor will be on our side. So we're going to take Paul to court. So they rose up against him, and they took him before the governor, and they wanted him to be judged and kicked out of their area because he was sharing the word of God. Look what they say. Look what they say. Verse number 13. They accused Paul of persuading people to worship God in ways that was contrary to our law. So they take Paul to court, and they try to convince the governor that Paul is sharing the word of God, and he's persuading people to worship in a way that is unlawful. They take Paul to court. And there are people who are being taken to court. There are preachers, even today, who have been taken to court. You remember the Houston Five, the five pastors in the area that the mayor, the former mayor of this area, wanted to take them to court, wanted to subpoena their notes. And people all over the world sent them Bibles, sent her Bibles, in order to tell her, this is where our notes come from. So they bring Paul into court. And when they bring him into court, something went wrong with their plan. Remember, God has already told Paul, I got plenty of people here that are supportive of you and supportive of me and my ministry, is what God tells Paul. He says, speak up, speak out. Don't be afraid, don't be silent. He says, whatever you do, keep preaching the word, is what God tells Paul. Verse 14 says, but just as Paul started to make his defense, when Paul started to defend himself, the governor himself spoke up. And the governor says, the Bible says the governor looks at the Jews and he says, look, you Jews, listen, you Jews, if you had a case involving wrongdoing and doing a serious crime, I would have a reason to accept your case. He says, if you had a serious crime, if you had some serious wrongdoing, I would have a reason to accept your case. But instead, he kicks them out of his courtroom. He kicks them out of the courtroom, and when he pushes them out of the courtroom, then the crowd grabbed the leader of the Jews in the synagogue. They grabbed him and they beat him. Verse number 17, they grabbed him and beat him right there in the court, right there in the courtroom, and the governor then say a mumbling word. That brings us to verse number 18. Now, throughout these passages, Priscilla has been mentioned, but most of the ministry from verses 1 through 17 deals with the Apostle Paul. Most of the ministry deals with the audacity of Paul to confront people with the word of God. And so we move to verses 18 through verses 28. The Sunday school lesson stops at verse 26, but verses 27 and 28 in Acts chapter 18 are very important. So let me just show you some nuggets that I found throughout these verses. There are some nuggets that I just want to drop on you and let you know what God is really, really saying. When you look at verse number 18, Paul stayed in Corinth sometime after, and then he went to say goodbye to the brethren. And when he said goodbye to the brethren, when he said goodbye to the brothers and the sisters, there he shaved his head according to the Jewish custom, marking the end of the vow. It was a Jewish custom that when you make a vow and you keep your vow, when the vow is over and when you have been consistent and you've reached your goal, the men would shave their heads. So Paul keeps the Jewish custom. He shaves his head. This identifies Paul as a Jew. It confirms him as a Jew. And not only that, Paul makes sure that they understand that he is going to maintain his Jewish heritage and he's going to respect the Jewish laws. They were saying that Paul was disrespectful to the Jewish law, but Paul keeps his vow. Paul keeps his vow. Paul keeps his vow. So Paul leaves and he moves to Ephesus. And he leaves people behind. But one point that you need to know, Paul takes Priscilla and Aquila with him. Now, this is a dangerous thing. He takes Priscilla and Aquila with him because you do know that the Jews had been pushed out, had been moved out, had been exiled, had been forced out by the previous governor. So there's a reason for him taking them with him, because number one, they're enthusiastic about ministry. He moves and he goes and he takes Priscilla and Aquila with him. So the brothers want him to stay. The sisters want him to stay. He declines to stay. He says to them, I will be back if God is willing. Verse number 21. I will be back if God is willing. You see, in ancient days, they acknowledged God's will, and they always preference everything that they would do according to God's will. We ought to know that we have to do things if God is willing. It's not in our control. We have to do it according to God's will. So Paul says, I will be back. I will be back to share with you more if God is willing. I used to say that, hear the old saints back home say that I'll be back if the Lord's willing. I will be there if the Lord's willing. So we need to understand that God is in control. The text points out that God is in control. Verse number 21, we need to understand that God is in control. And we need to agree to do things if God is willing. If God is willing. So Paul goes and he moves to visit the church at Jerusalem and then back to Antioch. Verse 23, after spending some time at Antioch, Paul went through Galatia. And when he gets there, he visits and strengthens the believers there. He also goes to Philippi. He strengthens the believers there. What we need to understand, everywhere we go, we ought to strengthen others. Every way we move, we ought to bless others. Every time we go somewhere, we ought to be a blessing to other people. And we ought to minister Jesus. Too often times, we go from point A to point B, and we do it on a daily and a weekly basis, and we don't say a word about Jesus Christ. We are called to minister. We are called to share Jesus Christ. We are called to share the gospel. Verse 24. Another person shows up on the scene in the text. His name is Apollos. Apollos was a very eloquent speaker. Apollos knew how to speak and get people attention. Apollos knew the word of God, and he knew the word of God well. Apollos arrives at Ephesus from Alexandria in Egypt. He had been taught in the way of the Lord. Apollo knew the word. Let me say to you, saints, you need to know the word of God. Apollos knew the word. That's why we're listening to the word, because we need to make sure that we know the word. If we're going to defend the faith, if we're going to stand for God, we need to know the word of God. And he was taught the word, the way of the Lord. He had been taught the way of the Lord. So not only did he know the word of God, he knew God's ways. He knew God's ways. He taught others about Jesus with an enthusiastic spirit. He had enthusiasm in his spirit. He was enthusiastic about the word of God. He was on fire for God. He spoke the word of God with enthusiasm. He had an enthusiastic spirit. And he did it with accuracy. He did it with accuracy. That's what it's meant right there in verse number 25. He did it. He ministered the word of God with accuracy. He did it with accuracy, but he had a problem. Apollos had a problem. However, he knew only John's baptism. He knew the word of God. He knew God's ways. He had enthusiasm when he spoke the word of God. He knew that book. We got to get to a point where we know the book. But Apollos had a problem. Apollos' problem was that he only knew about John's baptism, the baptism of the water. He didn't know about the Holy Spirit. He didn't know about Jesus Christ being the one who brings about fire, as John said. John says, I baptize with water, but there's one that comes after me, Jesus Christ. I'm not even worthy to lace up his shoes. He's going to baptize with fire. At this point, when Jesus comes into our heart, the fire of the Holy Spirit comes in. The Holy Spirit himself comes in. We ought to be enthusiastic about it. We ought to be enthusiastic about sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Verse 26, it says, when Priscilla and Aquila heard him preaching boldly, this guy, Apollos, he was enthusiastic about sharing the word, and he spoke with boldness. But when Priscilla and Aquila heard him speak boldly in the synagogue, they took him aside and explained the way of God even more accurately. Now, first of all, he knew the word. He knew the way of God. He was enthusiastic about it. But they pulled him aside and showed him how to explain the way of God even more accurately. They explained it to him in a very accurate way. Somebody need to pull somebody aside every now and then to explain to them the word of God in a more accurate way. None of us know everything. None of us have come to a point where we don't need to hear from anybody else. We are at a point in our lives where we need to hear somebody explain the word of God to us more accurately. As we've had technical difficulties this morning, somebody just threw up their hand and said, forget it. It ain't even worth it. But what we need to understand is we need to hear the word of God, and we need to press to hear the word of God in a very accurate way. One guy said to his children, all five of them, he said, you don't need to go to that church. I'm going to explain things to you at the house. And guess what? They're still wandering in the wilderness today. Because somebody need to pull somebody aside. I get pulled aside on a regular basis to be explained the word of God more accurately. So we ought to be willing to explain the word of God more accurately. And we need to be willing to listen to someone who will explain it to us. Verses 27 and 28 are left out of the Sunday school lesson, but let me just take you through that because that's very important. Apollos had been thinking about going to Arcadia. And the brothers and sisters in Ephesus encouraged him to go. Now, Apollos is enthusiastic about the word. He's enthusiastic about his missionary journey. He's been thinking about going, and the brothers and sisters encouraged him. Guess how they encouraged him? Number one, they encouraged him in words. And number two, they encouraged him in deeds. In other words, they encouraged him by saying, man, go ahead, you can do this. We ought to encourage people in words. We ought to tell people what they can do for the Lord in words. And they encouraged him with some moolah money. They encouraged him by giving to him. So they told him to go ahead. So they wrote to the believers in Arcadia, asking them to welcome him. You see, in churches, when our children go off to college and they go to another city, the pastor ought to call another pastor and say, hey, welcome the member of our church to your congregation. When my daughter went off to Denton, Texas, to college, I went there. I sit down. I met this pastor. I introduced myself. I went to church service with her. Said, this is my daughter. I want her to be a part of your congregation. Welcome her. And he had the whole congregation get up and clap and welcome her. We need to get to a point where we operate that way. We need to make sure that we speak up for people and operate in that manner. So he says, welcome him. When he arrived there, he proved to be a great benefit to those by God's grace who had believed. When he got there, he didn't let them down. He was a great benefit to that congregation. He was a great benefit to those who, by God's grace, had believed. Those who believed in Jesus Christ, he benefited them. And that's how ministry ought to work. It ought to work in such a way that as somebody did something to benefit us, we ought to do something to benefit others. We ought to do it God's way. Finally, verse number 28, and I give you my points for this lesson. Apollos refuted the Jews with powerful arguments in public. Apollos stood against the Jews, the people of the land. He stood against the Jews, the people of the laws. He stood against the Jews. He debated them even in public squares. He debated them in public. And guess what he used? This is why this verse is so important. He used scriptures. He explained to them that Jesus is the Messiah. Now, the Sunday school lesson leaves these two verses out, but I'm saying to you is the ultimate goal is to explain to people that Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the anointed one. Jesus is the one who relieves us and delivers us. My key learning from this lesson today. First of all, we ought to be able to answer the questions. What gifts, what skills have God given you to share the gospel of Jesus Christ? Number two, what skills are you willing to use to help others share the gospel in a more accurate way? So these are my points. We must enthusiastically share the gospel of Jesus Christ. We must enthusiastically share the gospel of Jesus Christ. We must share the gospel with accuracy. We must share the gospel with accuracy. You see, we feed sheep. We slop hogs. We are not in the hog slopping business. We're in the business of feeding the sheep. In order to feed sheep, we must do so with accuracy. We must share the gospel with accuracy. We must encourage others to share the gospel with accuracy. Just like Priscilla and Aquila pulls over Apollos, we must be willing to help other people share the gospel with accuracy. We must help somebody, put them on the right road, help them to share the gospel with accuracy. We must keep Jesus the main focus. We must make sure that Jesus stays the main thing of the main thing. We must keep Jesus the main focus. We must share the gospel in the face of risk. We must share the gospel of Jesus Christ in the face of opposition. We must share the gospel of Jesus Christ even though we know we're taking a risk. We must continue to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. The situation is critical, but your message of Jesus Christ is urgent. We must share the gospel of Jesus Christ, and we must share it even when there is risk. We must show appreciation to those who minister with us. Paul always called the roll of those who ministered with him. I send my greetings to Timothy. I send my greetings to Titus. I send my greetings to Priscilla and Aquila. I send my greeting to the saints of the church. We must show appreciation to those who minister with us. We must be willing to show appreciation to those who minister with us. God must be glorified in our ministries. God must be glorified in our ministries. God must be glorified. God must get the glory. We cannot deal with keeping God's glory. We have to allow God to keep his glory. God must be glorified in our ministries. We must use God's word when we witness. We must use the word of God when we witness. We must use God's word when we witness. Your testimony is good. Your testimony makes my spine shake. Your testimony put goosebumps all over my body. But your testimony is something that we praise God for, but your testimony does not compare to the word of God. We must use God's word when we witness. We must be bold in sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. We must be bold in sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. We must be bold. We must stand firm, have courage. We must be bold in sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. And finally, God protects us as we share the gospel. God protects us as we share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can't you see God saying to Paul, don't be afraid. Speak out. Don't keep silent. Whatever you do, share the gospel, because I got some people in that place. Does God have people in your place who's with God, who love the Lord? So whatever you do, know that God will protect you. And if you're listening to me today, you need to know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And out of obedience unto God, he gave his life as a ransom for you and me. You need to receive him today. And you can receive Jesus by bowing your head with me and just repeating this simple prayer. And you can receive him right now. Will you bow your head? Repeat after me, Lord Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you died for my sins. I believe that you rose from the dead. Now come into my life and make me a new person. Thank you for saving my soul. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and thank God. Thank you so much for joining us here at the New Beginning Church for our Sunday school. Please, ma'am, please, sir, keep coming in to our Sunday school. Brother Miles and Brother Whitlock are our regular Sunday school teachers. They allowed me to make an appearance today, and in the middle of making my appearance, my Wi-Fi just kept shutting down. We look forward to seeing you again at 10:45 this morning for our usual Sunday morning worship service, 10:45 a.m. this morning. You can also go to Carolyn Orr Davis, for our regular worship service on Sunday morning, 10:45. Be glad to be with you. Look forward to seeing you again. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we thank you now. We thank you for these words. We thank you for your Sunday school. We ask you to bless us, Father God, that we will walk in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank God. Thank you. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. God bless you and keep you is our prayer.